Welcome to the History Film Forum. How many fans of Timeless do we have out there? My name is Chris Wilson. I'm the Director of Experience Design here at the museum, and we're so happy to be doing the History Film Forum for a second time with our partners at the National Endowment for the Humanities, exploring how history is presented on the screen. When we were looking for programs to present as part of our second History Film Forum, we had a lot of documentary films that we wanted to show, and we were really looking for some things that were fun. And my colleague Dan Holm, who I know some of you have met, is working this program tonight, tipped me to Timeless and sent me the trailer. And I immediately said, we got to make this a part of the film forum. Before I worked here at the Smithsonian, I worked at a living history museum where we tried to really allow people to time travel through their experience. And the idea of time traveling, you know, is something that even at the Smithsonian is part of the experience when you see Dorothy's ruby slippers, or particularly when you see the objects related to Lincoln and the assassination. We have a wonderful collection here of items related to all the presidents, but particularly Lincoln and particularly the related to the assassination. Smithsonian collections come to us in a lot of different ways, and the materials associated with the Lincoln assassination came to the Smithsonian because they were really part of the War Department's investigation and evidence of the conspiracy. So we have so much of that, and when you are close to it, and visitors, the 4 or 5 million visitors who come here every year, see Lincoln's hat and see many of the objects connected with the end of his life, I think that it really allows them to time travel. That, of course, is what Timeless is all about as well, and I know that you're going to enjoy this episode featuring the Lincoln assassination, and then later we're going to meet the creators and the cast of Timeless. So thank you again, and enjoy the episode.
Hopefully this is on. Can you hear me? Yes? Hi, I'm Thomas Roberts from NBC News and MSNBC, and it's my pleasure to be here with you tonight. Did you enjoy Timeless? Yes? So how many of you at home already have this set on your DVR, or you've watched everything? Yes, all right. So good, because I'm just going to out myself now. I'm a super geek for this show. So I was so honored when they asked me to come and be a part of this, especially here at the Smithsonian. So conspiracy theories about the show, do we all have them too? Yes? Rittenhouse? Am I giving anything away if we talk about Abby's mother? I mean, Lucy's mom, Abby's the real person, but Lucy's mom? Abby's mom's great, okay? Lucy's mom, we're all gonna talk. But it's great to have you here, and we're gonna have a really fun time. So, if you'll all give warm applause to our panel we have tonight. Coming out first is Brian Taylor, who's from Georgetown University, our scholar, who's gonna keep us in check. And all right, and with our showrunners and creators, please welcome Shawn Ryan and Eric Kripke. Yes. Okay, and next I want to have you put your hands together for our favorite heroine of the show, Abigail Spencer. Okay, next, we know Wyatt as the tough hunk, but he's really nice. So please welcome Matt Lanter. All right, and certainly last but not least, the moral compass and the comedic, most of the time, relief for our timeless viewing is Malcolm Barrett. Please welcome Malcolm. Are you guys as geeked out as I am? I mean, this is like really cool. All right, so take a seat. Everyone has their microphones, okay? I was asking the audience about conspiracy theories, which we'll get into in just a little while. But Brian, for you, I know you had an opportunity to see the show, and then we'll talk about it in a second, but from the historical perspective and as a scholar, what strikes you about how great they do with this show? This is not a loaded question.
No, certainly not.
No. So how great do they do with this show, Brian?
Well,
yeah, Brian.
Yeah, Brian.
I was impressed that the premise here is that you're creating an alternate timeline with this show, right? And I still think that given that premise, that this show does better justice to the spirit of the time than, say, Hollywood movies like Gettysburg or Gods and Generals, in some sense, where there is a tendency to try and portray the war as about states' rights or something other than slavery, where here the slavery issue is really foregrounded and at the center of the moral, the ethical tension of the episode. So I was impressed with the pieces of the war that were foregrounded, especially considering what this is the second episode of the show, and so a lot of the action here you figure goes into setting up the dramatic tension between the characters and what's going to go on with the rest of the season. But at the same time, there's some fairly sophisticated conversations that could get started by this episode, like land redistribution. Gets mentioned by one of the characters as a possibility had Lincoln lived. And that's not something, having talked with the sort of members of the American public about the Civil War, it's not, I think, something that's terribly widely known, that land redistribution, the idea of breaking up the plantations and giving land to the recently enslaved, to freedmen and women, is something that was considered. I don't think a lot of Americans know that. And so I think just introducing that idea is somewhat of a radical thing, especially for a second episode for a TV show to do. So I was certainly impressed in seeing the show for the first time.
Good answer.
Thank you.
All right.
Wyatt won't have to beat you up now.
Yeah.
That's my whole goal.
I was
not
getting
to get
warmed
beat
up over here.
I could feel it.
So for Shawn and Eric, for pitching a show like this and running and executive producing a show like this, give everybody kind of the backstory, how it came together, and the idea to put this together, where not only is it a docu-series, but it's also a scripted drama, because you have history as your guide.
Yeah, I'd say pitching the show is easier than making the show. it started because Eric had been fiddling around with this idea for a while, and he had decided that he wanted a partner to kind of help develop it, and he cold called me. We work at the same studio at Sony, and you know, did I want to hear a pitch of his? And I get called a lot by writers who want to pitch me something, but they are almost never
as awesome as me,
and as credentialed as Mr. Kripke. And I just found that odd because I knew he didn't need me to sell a show, and you know, what's that about? And so I sat down with him, and he had the germ of this idea, and it was something like something I wanted to do. I'd never done anything in this sort of genre before. I knew he was sort of a master of the genre. I wanted to learn. It also, I think, appealed to both of us to have someone as experienced as each of us was to sort of lean on, because making shows is tough. And we said, well, let's spend a week together in a writer's room. Let's sort of see if we can flesh this idea out, and A, see if we think there's an idea here worth doing, and B, see whether we hate each other.
In the writers, where did you start? Can you fill us in on like where you started? I mean, is it at the natural story arc of where we meet the characters in episode one?
No, we spent a lot of time in that first week just sort of talking about the show. You know, you really start at the satellite view when you start creating, because you're not even just trying to create a pilot, you're trying to create an entire series, you know? So we really started with like, okay, who are the characters? Even just questions of like, how many people are gonna be in the machine? And you know, and landing.
Don't ask Gia.
yeah, exactly. And you know, and then
someone's
landing.
Keeping up.
Yep, someone's on top.
Up to date on his episodes.
Look, there is not enough time for all of this. But so, in my mind. But go back.
Yeah. So then, Well, you clearly...
Because I'm a dork about this show. I love this show.
For sure. You're busting out Gia, like, in 5 minutes in, man.
I'm worried about Gia.
So,
I'm worried. Yeah. I'm worried, and now I think she's got the visions. She's got sight.
She's got the vapors.
She's got the vapors.
She's got the sight.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Who are the characters? What are they like? What makes them tick? What's just the math of the show? What is it every week that can sustain itself? And those are the initial conversations. And then only then, once you really start to figure that out and where do they arc out throughout the entire series, do you start to have conversations of, all right, if we were going to do a pilot, what would we make the pilot about? And, for instance, we chose that. Honestly, there's a lot of reasons we chose the Hindenburg. One of the main ones was we looked at each other and we said, they're going to give us more money to make a pilot. And so let's go with the most expensive idea that we could think of.
Might as well,
That they would never let us do in series. And we were like, all right, let's crash a friggin' blimp. And, the pilot and the actual story comes very late. I think Sean and I are both writers that really begin with character. And who are they? And how do we have really complex human people that we really care about? And then, of course, you hand it over to these geniuses, and then they're the ones who really bring the character.
But also,
to life.
History is a huge main character for you that everybody gets to work with.
Yeah.
Part of our pitch to NBC, we pitched it to a lot of networks, and had a few that wanted to buy it. NBC ended up being the most excited about it. But part of our pitch was, we're going back in history. There's literally thousands of stories we can tell. We're not going to be limited because, truth is stranger than fiction in many ways. Mm-hmm. And part of our job is to find that truth that is strange and unbeknownst to people. And we have a very scholarly, smart writer's room. And there's nothing better than finding out some historical detail that none of us knew about. Because if none of us heard about it and knew about it, the chances are that the audience isn't going to know about it. And how do you take that and turn it into a story?
Yeah, I would say the main reason I became a writer was for the research. Like, I think just the research is fascinating. And really, I have this other show, Supernatural. And the only reason I did that show is because it would be fun to research urban legends. And for this show, really the only... When he says I brought him the kernel of the idea, really the only... kernel I had was, man, wouldn't it be fun to just research history every week? And if you did a different historical story every week, you could get 1,000 episodes of that, and it would always be an interesting job. And because, if you're on a show, God forbid all of us were on a show for 5+ years, like, you want it to be interesting and not like the same old thing. So that
for me,
really,
it's not God forbid.
That.
You better be on for 5 years.
God forbid.
So. You don't have to make
it. We're on
a
show
thing,
together,
buddy. You don't have to make it.
Well, we bow at your feet and we hope you do make it for 5 years. And I need to move my chair up because I can't see Abby enough.
Yeah. I can work with you.
No. So Abigail Spencer, who is Lucy. Don't we love Lucy? The character of Lucy. I was lucky enough to sit next to Abby on the bus over here and basically harass her about what a nerd I am for the show. Mm-hmm. And we bonded over that. But how fun.
We bonded over harassment.
Bonded over harassment, yes.
Really keeps people together.
Nothing reportable to HR, but it's all good. But for you, how fun has it been to have a show and a character that not only is smart, but relatable, vulnerable, fun to play, and someone that we can all admire, like a strong female heroine that TV kind of lacks here and there.
We need it on television. I'm so forever grateful to these wonderful human beings next to me for creating her, because my mother made all my clothes growing up, and I played with paper dolls, and I wanted to find myself in the story. I wanted to see myself in the people that were playing out these, magical things I would see on television. So the fact that I get to do that now through Lucy is a dream come true, because there's the historical component and there's the fashion component. I mean, that's a big part of history as well, is all of the different fashions and her kind of blending in and her obsession and her love. And even today, what we got to do, thank you, by the way, the Smithsonian, for having us. This has been such a joy and a pleasure and an honor. And we got to go to the underbelly of the Smithsonian and see kind of behind the scenes and, you know, just seeing Ginger Rogers' costume and the history that went into that. I mean, and then the personal stories behind, you know, we got to see what Lincoln used to write the Emancipation Proclamation to end slavery. And, you know, we burst into tears because that's what it's about. It's the, about the emotional component and being moved as a human being and to play a woman and to play these characters that you can project yourself onto who are experiencing it for all of us. You know, that's kind of the hope. And I think that's the joy of playing Lucy, is that she's so in love with all of these, you know, these people and these moments through history, and then she gets to experience it for herself, and hopefully that's what you all can do, is find yourself in Lucy's shoes and Wyatt and Rufus's shoes and experience it through us. So it's a complete and utter joy.
And hopefully you don't find yourself in Amy's shoes. Where's Amy? Okay? That's what I got in the comment. Where's Amy? So, I want to know where she is. Matt, for you, you know, why it's like the hunk with the heart of gold? Is that fair?
My mother also made my dresses when I was young, too.
Who knew that they were both Dolly Parton?
I think Wyatt is just... he's a guy that wants to do good, and I think that a lot of people can relate to that. I think we all want to do good. You know, Wyatt's the guy that, in my opinion, he's a hero. I mean, I have a supreme respect for the military, and I think those guys are the real heroes. And so getting to play Wyatt gives me a little bit of opportunity to dive into their world physically, but also emotionally, and their relationships as well. So, it's a treasure chest for me to be able to play.
Well, and the great thing is you guys all play off of each other so well. And Malcolm, for Rufus, like I say, he's the, you know, kind of the moral compass and also the comic relief in a lot of different parts. But all three of these characters come from really uniquely different backgrounds. And I think we all grow in watching you guys together trust each other as a team. Is it as honest on screen as it is between the three of you?
No,
okay. This is the best. Yes.
I wouldn't be on the same flight as these two over here.
But we all agreed to that, so that's
that's our common bond.
That's the heart of it.
Well, at least that's a commitment that we can all respect.
No, you know, it's very interesting. I think the reason it works on screen is that we are able to build off of each other in real life. We have, you know, we sit and sing songs and make really bad jokes with each other, and are probably
strongest when it's all. Yeah, I did that.
Three of us together.
Look at that. They share a mic. I mean, this is
without
synergy.
Even a word.
Yeah.
That was excellent. So we have a lot of fun, and you know, and we've been able to build that character, that fun into the characters as we've began to learn with each other. You know, much like the characters, we were sort of thrown into this completely new world with a bunch of new challenges and forced to be with each other 24 hours a day. forced to be with each other 24 hours a day. And
which
is essentially what happens with
kind
our characters.
Of
and so,
when you
know,
make a pilot and all yeah. that stuff, you don't know each other, and then you're like, oh, make this thing.
Yeah, and we wind up, you know, sort of steel sharpening steel. You know, we sort of feed off of each other, and I think all of our characters have grown, and you've seen a little bit more. You know, there's a huge arc with Rufus, who is probably the most reluctant in going on a time traveling adventure into American history.
Why?
Hate to hit it on the hit it on the head there, but being black. is part of it, aside from the fact that he's an introvert and a homebody and a nerd. And but what's great is that you see the growth of all of these characters and how they're shaped through this. You see how Wyatt's changed and how he's become, you know, not just mission-oriented, but also how he's related to his peers. You see Lucy, you see Rufus coming out. And so that's been the fun of this, is much like she said, much like our creator said, is that at the heart of all of this is a bunch of humans going through superhuman circumstances and learning to grow because of it.
But you guys also do have a contrast in vulnerabilities where there have been instances where it's hard to trust one another. And certain, you know, Mason, who set you up to kind of be a double agent with spying on them for Rittenhouse. Hopefully I'm not giving anything away.
Yeah, spoiler alert on the first episode of the show that you've come to the Smithsonian to talk about.
And Amy's missing, okay? So
in the episode I've before, said Lucy it. Comes home and her sister is missing, and that kind of like catapults us into the danger of every time you change something in history, what is the butterfly effect for the future?
Amy's don't exist. Is there an Amy here? Anyone named Amy?
See?
Okay. So so we've proven that right. But yeah, so there is absolutely the butterfly effect, but for the consequences that have happened for the team, what do you think was the best or most authentic moment for the team? Which episode or which experience that got you through building the bond of trust for each other? I mean, where do we see that? Because there are moments where you guys are in conflict.
One of the first kind of major times that happens is the French and Indian War, when they're at each other's throats, and then Rufus steps in when we're captured, tied to a pole, and we're about to die. And his
episode
character.
Episode 6, if you have.
Yeah, sorry.
7. It's 106.
So 106. 106.
They've all seen it. Raise your hands. You've all seen almost every episode, right?
Okay, okay.
There you go.
All right. See,
you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah. You went like this. I don't. Yeah. You did like that. Now I can't trust you.
Earmuffs.
So.
And Rufus's character steps up and essentially says, "You're not. You know, if they're going down, I'm going down. You know." So I think that's the first time we really see them step up together and kind of face things together.
And Eric, is as Malcolm pointed out, some of the difficulties for this team traveling back in history, they're all vulnerabilities, different vulnerabilities that's going to be enlightened for the people that they are modern day. They're all upgraded, 2016, 2017 individuals being hurled back into time. How tough is that for you to get right and for your team to get right in writing for the emotions and the reality of what they get hurled into?
That is an interesting and insightful question. It.
Where's Amy?
The subtext.
I'll take the first one first.
Okay.
We really look and we really aim to make a show that's character first and genre second. You know, we really used from the beginning, movies like Close Encounters and E.T. and the sort of early 80s Spielberg stuff that we all grew up in that was just very like fiercely humanistic, and there's something that happened in genre, I think recently, or in some genre that isn't as successful, that focuses more on, the bells and whistles rather than just the people. And so we always work hard to make it about the characters. And so the short answer is it's really friggin' hard because we go, if there's any, we don't spend nearly as much time going, layering the plot. We'll lock the plot in, but we'll really look to see what is each character going through. And sometimes it's like 3 to 5 characters that all need credible and emotional arcs. And you're trying to balance them all. Every episode, not to be like super nerdy, but every episode has a very specific thematic that we talk about beforehand, whether it's facing your worst fear, whether it's dealing with your family legacy, whether it's this one of whether they should be even doing the job they're on, or whether they should, you know, actually try to make things better. You know, and for Wyatt, that's about his wife, and for, you know, Lucy and Rufus, it's about Lincoln. And so there, it's this balancing act of weaving all of these threads together, and it comes through hard labor. There's no easy way to do it. I wish the truth of writing was you sit down and you're just, you've done it again, you magnificent bastard, but it's not. It's not at all. It's just painful and hard, and there's a reason they call it breaking story. And so that's, you know, that's really what we do.
You get to have an adventure with their travels. Are there certain historical facts that you've been researching? Because I know, as you said, with Supernatural, it's kind of going with those urban myths and legends. This, you actually get to use history as your guide. Has there been one thing that you researched, or more than one, that really shocked the hell out of you that happened?
Bass Reeves, the guy who was one of the inspirations for the Lone Ranger, and the marshal who was one of the most successful marshals in the Old West. And our writer, Jim Barnes, found him and pitched him to us. And the guy was so amazing, like, you know, and his quotes were, like, we took a lot of his quotes word for word and gave them to him as dialogue. And, like, you know, and the fact that, like, the best lawman in the Old West was African-American, was an escaped slave, was defending the law of a country that just a few years earlier had him in bondage, but still believed in the purity of the law and had these amazing quotes that I'm paraphrasing, which is the law is imperfect, but it's all that we've got, and insisted whenever possible of bringing people in alive and making sure they had due process. The guy was unbelievable, and I had no idea who he was before Jim pitched him to me, and then the more we started talking about him, like, Shawn and I both, we started to get on, like, this train where we're like, it's our duty to present this guy to America. Like, people need to know who this guy is. And so to have...
Which we essentially gave to Rufus as dialogue, you know, at the end of the episode.
Right. It's true. And so to have a job where you get to stumble onto that, which for us, and I'm sure historians knew who he was, but I sure as hell didn't.
Right.
And so to be able to learn that and then to be able to present it to a couple million people, that's a treat, man. That's just a cool job.
I mean, that's part of the cool thing is, how do we make history cool? You know what I mean? Like, how do we make it digestible? How do we make it where the whole family can enjoy it together? And how do you, through the show, you're learning, you're having a new history lesson every single week. I mean, that's part of the draw, and also the joy is that we get to even be a part of that. And you know, I came into the writer's room too and asked, you know, why this show, why now? You know, why do we need it now? And really, I think we're all thinking about our futures. You know, we're thinking about, how do we change our future? How do we not repeat the same mistakes? The only way to do that is to look at the past. And so this is like an enjoyable, fun, you know, kind of, and I think it's a very beautiful show, and there's, you know, glamorous costumes, and you know, hopefully you think great acting, and you get to kind of absorb this and really reflect on the future through the past. And that's what I think is kind of the deeper, more zeitgeist of where the show exists.
Well, and Hidden Figures, you know, one of the more successful movies this year. I mean, you guys...
Hidden Figures!
Kind of... But, I mean, your show, kind of ahead of the curve on that, you're illuminating Hidden Figures within our own histories of...
And that just where we've got... Like, you guys know that the movie was coming out when you guys...
Coincidental?
We had talked about this.
We found out about it when we were too late to turn back. And we were
you guys thought about it before the movie.
Yes. So. And then we were like,
I saw this episode before that movie. I haven't even seen Hidden Figures because I love your show so much. So.
Yeah, thank you.
Now that's
That's a testament to the speed of
television. But I give you credit.
It's a testament to the speed of television versus film. We had when we made the pilot, when you make a pilot, they want you to give them like 5-6 sample episodes that you might do later. And one of the ones we did was, you know, the day that man landed on the moon in 1969, space race. And we knew we wanted to do that arena. And in the room, we talked about who were all the figures there. And at one point, a big part of the story was going to be the astronaut wives. And then we couldn't quite make that story work. And then we had talked about Katherine Johnson and actually had ejected her from the story for a little while. Trying to do this astronaut wife thing didn't work. And then finally, I remember Eric coming to my office, Sean, you know, we need Katherine Johnson in the story.
It's such a great episode because you get to see Malcolm's character, Rufus. You know, this is like one of his inspirational heroes. Right. And that's such a sweet moment to see.
Well, and that was the key. That was actually the key for us because we were trying to do a Lucy astronaut wives thing that we just couldn't quite make work. And the minute we said, wait a second, this is the space race, this is NASA, this is mission control, really, emotionally, this is actually a Rufus story.
Yeah.
Right? And the minute we realized that that's where the emotional heart of that story lay, that's when Katherine Johnson came in. And so, then we heard about this movie that they're making after we were sort of down the road on this, and you're like, well, you hear about thousands of movies. Yeah, this won't get any attention. Yeah,
no one's going to know about that movie. Let's just go ahead. No one's going to know about that movie.
And we're going to be on the air anyways before. Yeah. And stuff well, that. But I feel like they're great companion pieces. Yeah. And,
no, they really are.
Yeah, and I think there's an interesting point, too, of where, you know, look, our job is to try to recreate history as accurately as possible, but we have to service a story, and this is a good example of where they diverge. The truth of it was Katherine wasn't in Mission Control that weekend. She worked at Mission Control. She had that job. That was her backstory. It was all accurate. She was actually with friends, I think, in upstate New York watching the rocket launch. And that was one of our big things that we wrestled with because we were like, she wasn't really there. And we were like, but she did all of those things. And she really did know how to work the computer when no one else was paying attention. And there's all these details that, and so you have to start to take, it's an interesting conversation while we're up here on stage, like it's impossible to be 100% accurate. You have to take these certain liberties to get to the spiritual truth of the story. And to illuminate that character at that time for that moment, we had to take a fictional liberty, which is putting her in a location. Everything else about her, everything we said about her was true, but putting her in a location that she wasn't actually at.
A little creative license. A
little bit.
I didn't know it. You didn't have to tell me. I totally believed you.
I didn't mean to ruin it for you.
The whole thing, that special moment with Rufus, now it didn't happen.
Rufus wasn't there, really,
Yeah, Rufus
either.
Wasn't really there.
I wasn't there.
And I have another, like, time travel's fictional, too. Sorry.
You guys.
It hasn't happened yet. It's not necessarily, or it already has.
That was going to be one of my last
questions.
If
somebody's here from the future and time traveled back, raise your hand.
I would love to talk to you, actually.
Yeah. But Brian, so specifically for the Lincoln episode, and you know, as we hear from Eric and Sean about sometimes there's a little creative liberty license that goes with it. What did they get right, and
what could we slightly have improved upon?
Sure.
I mean, if you can improve on perfect, how would you?
Again, I was impressed that a lot was right.
Be rough, man. Come on. No, we want to hear it.
You can be rough.
Well, I will be rough in a second. not that rough. I was impressed that you have this scene where black soldiers talking with Rufus and dictating one of these advertisements that gets placed in newspapers as the Civil War is ending, and for decades after the Civil War, where he's trying to track down members of his family who he was separated from as a result of the slave trade, right? I mean, I thought there was some really good stuff in there. You do say that on April 14th, 1865, slavery is outlawed, and that's not literally true. This is gonna be a really academic distinction for a second, but bear with me. It's on its way to being outlawed for sure, right? And it's clear to most people that slavery is on the way out. But slavery didn't actually die until December 1865 when the 13th Amendment was ratified. It was through Congress by this point, but it hadn't been ratified yet. So why does that matter? Why, you know, that academic distinction I'm making? One of the arguments you hear these days is that the Civil War was not really necessary because slavery would have died out anyway. It was kind of on its way out as a global institution, and this was all sort of unnecessary. Those abolitionists just could have kept the lid on things. Slavery was going to go away. Slavery hasn't gone away today, by the way. There's 10 million people enslaved in the on the planet today. So the idea that slavery was going to be phased out of this country without a massive war in the 1870s or 1880s is very simplistic. But one of the ways that we argue against this idea that slavery was dying out and the war was unnecessary was by showing how strong as an institution it is, that it takes this cataclysmic war, 750,000 Americans dying, and a fundamental restructuring of the Constitution, the reconstitution of the Constitution with the 13th Amendment, and it still outlasts the war. In my home state of Delaware, the Emancipation Proclamation didn't cover it, and it didn't abolish slavery of its own volition, so men and women were enslaved until December of 1865. And I'm not saying that you were wrong to not give that really long speech in this 45-minute episode.
Lucy
right?
could have done I mean, it.
We wrote it. We had to cut it for time.
Yeah, Lucy.
You know,
I can only
it's in the director's cut.
I think I saw some people falling asleep while I was talking, so I understand, you know, which is something I'm used to. I understand
not,
why you didn't.
I'm with you. I like it.
It makes sense
Acting.
That you didn't do that. I mean,
no.
I think one of the... One of the struggles everybody who does history has is how do you balance making history entertaining and keeping people's attention with doing justice to the time period and the complexity and nuance of the past? And I think the point is well taken that sometimes sort of small inaccuracies can serve larger thematic purposes. Like, it's more important to talk about the fact that slavery is ending with the Civil War, maybe, than to get into the academic, if you only have 45 minutes, right, to talk about this
42.
Period, then, for, hey, 42, even better.
Well, it's recently called involuntary immigration.
I saw that.
Just,
I saw that.
Okay. So,
I saw that.
As long as we're...
Does everybody know who Frederick Douglass was, by the way?
Yeah, he gave a speech just the other day.
He's doing
it.
He's
pretty good.
He really loves the show, apparently.
He's doing a hell of a job. Hell of a job.
He loves the show, actually.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's
He tweeted
also...
me earlier about yeah. how much he loves this panel.
It's pretty good. I love his Twitter. but, you know, that's also the difficulty, which is partially why I did the show and what we're working at, because we are in uncharted ground with dealing with history and dealing with having African-Americans be leads in shows like this. And so I think it's very much things that we try and work towards. Even in the course of that episode, you know, I remember Tom Smuts, I believe, was the writer on that episode. And I remember having conversations even about things like, I was like, I feel like there's too many black people in this room. Like, would there be that many black people in the midst of all these white people at this area? And, you know, that's the other hard thing about the thing of, like, there are laws that are made, and then there's where it gets followed and where the community is. And, you know, Juneteenth is like, you know, slavery is outlawed, and then there's when they towed the slaves.
That's another thing.
That they're...
Slavery may be outlawed, but there's plenty of slave owners across the South who are trying to keep that information.
Exactly,
from,
yeah, who are trying to keep that. So that's always the interesting thing and the balance in trying to find that. Even the ad-lib that we came up with on the pilot episode where I get off the bus and I say, well, the back of the bus was awesome, you know, that... That wasn't in the script. That was the result of the experience of going like, okay, what are the laws at the time? And if we're all getting off of this bus, which it was done as a flash. It was done. It was like bus came, cut to us coming off the bus, and then dialogue happens. And, you know, I had this thing where I'd been talking. I was like, look, for Rufus, if this bus is segregated, this is probably one of the first by law racist practices that he's experiencing and he's experiencing firsthand. So I probably have a completely different experience than the rest of these individuals. And so that's where it got...
Now Lucy's looking around like, oh yeah, my yeah. God, the wonder...
Lucy's like, this pass is amazing. I'm like, the bus sucks. Like... Which I think is a metaphor a lot for the black experience in the past as well as today, where we have different experiences. You know, you talk about Get Out, where, you know, where you're put into the mind of an African-American as a lead character here. For this, it's very much we're learning, okay, what are the experiences that these people are having and what are experiences that Rufus is having from this perspective. And it's a hard thing to get right because it is this thing of, you know, caring about history, of telling this story, of telling this people. But it's also very rewarding when you are able to combine all of that. Like, to piggyback back on that Bass Reeves thing, for me, that's amazing because shortly before this, there was a Lone Ranger movie where the lead character is white.
And now that we are able to have this platform talking about Bass Reeves is going to make people have second thoughts mm-hmm. when that character is introduced into the zeitgeist. You know, it is very empowering, very inspiring to be able to reclaim these historical heroes. And for me, coming from where I'm from, it's very important because it makes me a part of history in a way that is sometimes neglected.
I think one of the big things that we discuss a lot of the time as well is that we are from the future and we can't actually come in with a lot of judgment to people that don't know any better. I think we have to hold a lot of empathy and compassion for the people that we're dealing with and also be careful what we say because we don't know how we're going to, you know, divert or push a character or a decision in a certain direction. And like even in the NASA episode as well, you know, Lucy confronts there's a guy in the NASA office like who assumes she's a secretary and is kind of bossing her around mm-hmm. and you kind of see Lucy like, you know, brain scramble and like, oh yeah, he doesn't know any better and kind of have to comply until she can't take it anymore and she kind of rises up and says something for the women in you know, for the women around her, not necessarily for herself, but for the future. But we had to really talk about that. Like, what is that like? And how much does she say? And she can't just be mad at this person for just being him because he didn't know any better. And I think
someone who might have been considered progressive 100 years ago yeah. might be considered a racist now.
Right.
In many ways.
Like Abraham Lincoln in some senses, right? I mean, a lot of, you know, for his time period, he's remarkably racially enlightened. He's the great emancipator. But there's things he says, he uses racist terms throughout his life that by today's standards would be, you know, we would call those racist.
So we all hope, you know, when we know better, we do better. But yeah, you guys get thrust in these situations where you do go back and you are dealing with people that you think are evolved to a certain point to know better, to be doing better. But are there a lot of moments, and Malcolm, you mentioned this about ad-libbing. Do you guys find moments like that? Or is
all the time.
Do you?
Well, we try. I mean, you know, some things come out naturally, mm-hmm. and they're great about it and let us try things, and some things make the cut and some things don't.
So what is the best ad lib that ever made it?
Well, I mean, Malcolm Barrett in the pilot, ladies and gentlemen.
I mean that's yeah. my longest ad lib.
Yeah.
Yeah, we had written his speech when he's sort of locked up in the jail and he goes on about that. And we'd written an okay kind of version, but on the day it was sort of, you know, it was playing okay but not great. And we just sort of said, yeah. Say what you want. And, you know, probably 30% of what he ended up doing was sort of words that we had in there in some form, and then 70% was what he was sort of coming up with. And, you know, he turned on this sort of Michael Jordan, Michael Jackson, he went Black Day Michael sort of thing that we were just, you know, all trying not to laugh in Video Village to ruin the sound.
That's what I also do love when you introduce yourselves and you're like Dr. Dre or you're somebody else. Like,
you know,
this
but
is my colleague.
There's all kinds of examples. You know, Matt did something wonderful, I thought, in this episode that wasn't scripted where, you know, Rufus went to sort of try to get the bullet out and do the bzzz, like the you know, game of Operation, which, I, you know, when I was watching the first cut, it wasn't the script, so I didn't see that coming. It just made me laugh my ass off. There was an episode where our Watergate episode where, you know, Lucy was supposed to come in this window and sort of rescue him, and she did this pratfall that I had no idea was coming. That was like the most amazing fall and roll and up and oh, I've got it. That in this moment, I just thought it was hysterical.
It was so fun to do. I mean, they give us a lot of room to play the humanity of our characters, to not be the hero, and then overcome that and become the hero. And that's really part of the joy, is finding the right moment to explore that and do that.
Has there been a favorite period of time that you've gotten to explore, whether it's through a certain episode or through just certain research? Is there a special period of time that y'all like? Man. For good reasons, not so much for bad reasons. Yeah, like,
I think, yeah. I mean, just as far as just if we're talking time period itself, just visually, I loved seeing the 20s Paris. I didn't get to be a part of that because I was in jail.
Yeah.
But I was doing the show. I was doing cool things in jail. But
But
no,
but
you
visually,
missed Josephine
really,
Baker. You missed a lot, man.
I missed a
I'm
lot.
Sorry.
No, yeah. I know. But I got to watch it.
Yeah.
You know, that's the cool thing is that even when we're not a part of it, it's like, what were they doing? You know, I can't wait to see that.
You did get a sick time in the 80s, though.
That's true.
And I told Matt earlier that that blue members-only jacket, I want it.
We're going to find it. We'll see if we can.
As a kid, all I wanted in the eighth grade was a black members only jacket so I could go to Skateland, and we were too poor to get one. So, sorry moment. No. I mean, I mean, I'd probably be mortified now if I had an eighth grade picture of me in a members only jacket. So.
And can we hit it?
Yeah, right. Oh, there it is. But I loved seeing that episode. I'm an 80s kid, and I thought that was a lot of fun for you guys, and especially to see your characters bond, because we get to see a lot of Lucy with Rufus or Lucy with Wyatt, but the two of you having an opportunity to grow in your friendship.
It was fun for me.
It was cool.
It was fun for me and Malcolm. We had a good time with that, and I also do think it's interesting to form the bonds between a couple of the characters where you're not having everyone and they're not on some kind of a dire mission, although that ended up being a pretty serious one. I think it's always fun to strengthen relationships between different characters, and then when you come together, it's even better.
And some of my favorite moments of the show, and what I love doing, is really connecting with the people from the past. I really love the Bonnie and Clyde episode, and I think for that reason is that each of us, we were, Wyatt and Lucy were on their own journey, but also Rufus, we really got to spend some time with people and get to know them, and you get connected to them. And I think even in the Lincoln episode, Lucy and Lincoln's son, and it's...
Yes, sexual tension there for
so
sure.
Much sexual tension.
There was a
tension.
Lot of sexual tension between Lincoln's son and Lucy.
I mean, there's a high school named after Juliet Shakespeare.
Yeah. I think
Ohio,
he's coming back somehow. That's another one of my conspiracy theories. Lincoln's son is going to show up at somewhere, be a love interest for Lucy. It's right?
Wink.
That's in there.
Yeah. Well,
which is an interesting question. How old, I'll ask the historian, because how old was Robert Todd Lincoln about that time? Because
he would have been, I guess, mid-20s.
Yeah, about 20.
Works for me.
20, yeah, we cheated, cheated the age up a little bit in the casting.
Well,
contemporary of
There was a girl named Lucy whom Robert Todd Lincoln and John Wilkes Booth were both sort of vying for.
No, get
yes.
out of here.
No, I swear to
See?
God.
See?
I swear to God.
That's what we're talking about.
Her name was...
wait, break that down. Tell us.
Her name was Lucy Hale, and she was the daughter of a congressman, Everett Hale, I think.
And
he was from Massachusetts. He's from New England. He was an abolitionist. Yeah. And Robert Todd Lincoln later in life would sort of deny this. There were some weird connections between the Booth family, the Lincoln family, that you guys mentioned in the episode, Edwin Booth.
They were Eskimo brothers, is what you're saying.
to use the parlance of the times, I suppose. I don't think they would have said that necessarily, but okay. But so you guys got very close on that particular detail. Girl named Lucy.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wait, can we share this? I don't know if this is like a Smithsonian secret. I hope not.
There's so many. I'm not privy to any of this.
Rittenhouse is in the basement.
Well, we will.
Is all the Rittenhouse stuff? Yeah.
We're on this tour today behind the scenes, and we see Abraham Lincoln's watch. They actually brought out his watch, and they were telling us a story about this inscription that was actually in the clock, which I guess you guys have seen that episode.
Yes.
They hide all the things in the clock.
Yeah, and there was his watch would have to be serviced, and as professional sort of watch cleaner stuff did that, knowing it was Lincoln's watch, they would actually inscribe little things on the inside of the watch, mostly in support. Although one person did inscribe Jeff Davis,
defaced it.
Yeah, deface it that way, and then close it, and you couldn't see it from the outside. So that was the setup, and
so. Do you see the correlation?
Yeah, we're saying,
so the guy's like, yeah, so these little messages inside clocks. I'm like, that's what our show is about, is messages hidden inside clocks and watches.
No, well, it's timeless. It's absolutely timeless.
We have questions from our audience, and right? So we're gonna have people go up to the microphones? Yes. And do we have folks that are lined up and ready to go?
Amy?
Why don't you ask one more and they can line up?
I will come to you if my microphone is long enough. How about that? Yeah.
There we go.
We'll start with you.
All right. This is 30 seconds of setup for 10 seconds of question that all five of you guys will appreciate. I promise once we get to the question.
Okay. I feel prepared.
This guy's great. Brian's great, by the way, too. Smithsonian and National Endowment for the Arts or Humanities. Thank you very much for having them. You guys have given me one of the greatest entertainment experiences I've ever had, and I've seen a lot of TV. I watched the pilot and thought it was good. I said, okay, I'll watch this next one. I watched the second episode that we just saw, and I was floored. I want to say blown away, but you know what happened.
Too soon?
Way too soon.
I was floored by that episode. I was like trying to get everybody in the world into it after that. Wow. But the show has actually gotten better since then. It's astonishing to me. And I'll leave it to the actors to expand upon if you want to go into how you portray your characters or whatever you've done, and you guys and how you make the show. But it's actually gotten better since those episodes. And if you want to say what you've learned in making Timeless, I think you could all go off that. And thank you again. You guys are phenomenal.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You guys. What have you learned about your characters as the season has progressed?
Well, look, that's the mode, hopefully, or the mark of a good series, right? Is that your pilot is good or solid or has some basis behind it, some meat and potatoes, and then hopefully you grow and explore all these ideas that you set up from the very beginning. So that's hopefully what's happening here. For me, it's been very clear the arc of my character because he's been forced to be out of his own skin for so much in a less subtle way than these two. It's literally him going, I don't want to go, and they go, like, you're going. So I think for that, I'm learning more and more what makes him tick in his humanity, you know what I mean? And I think not much has changed about Rufus. It's just the situations around him and how he's needed to grow, you know what I mean? I don't feel as though I've completely changed from being 14 to 34 or 36, however old I am. I was supposed to lie.
I'll IMDb it later.
What are we saying these days?
But there's a core humanity that you always are, and it's the situations around you that make you grow and force you to go harder into the decisions that you might have made, and that for me has been Rufus. It's, you know, I never expected him to kill, but once he did, I expected him to feel guilty about it, and to have to wrestle with that. And so that's what I'm learning. I'm learning all the ways that Rufus is growing, and seeing him have to deal with the heart and person he was from the pilot and the person he's become now.
I would add from a writing perspective that this show is about learning from history, and I think as writers, we learn from the history of those first batches of episodes, right? You know, if you're paying attention, you're seeing what's working, you're seeing the elements, you know, the characters you get to know better. Almost all the writers on our show got a chance to write a second script, and I would say almost universally, their first drafts of their second scripts were better than their first drafts of their first scripts. You know, once you get to start watching episodes, and you start living and breathing the show, and we start understanding these characters better on the page, and they start understanding them better, and directors are able to come in and see more episodes that they can draw off of. You have a basis of understanding, and as long as you can keep the stories fresh and the obstacles new and interesting, I agree with you. I think the show got better as it went on, and part of it was the writing, the big part was these guys. The crew and the directors, they get better too, and you just start fine-tuning into what works on the show.
All right, so questions over here, sir?
All right, so I want to first of all thank you for creating an engaging and interesting show that causes people to look deeper into history, to look into these figures like Bass Reeves and others. So thank you for that.
Well, thank you.
One of the challenges that, I'm a professional Civil War historian, third book coming out later this year.
Nice.
One of the challenges that I think all of you have in translating history to the screen is getting those little details right. And so in this episode, I really enjoyed the fact that when Rufus and White put on the uniforms, they were horrible uniforms. Especially compared with Robert Todd Lincoln and the USCT soldiers they ran into. But I have to ask, was that intentional to have them wearing artillery uniforms with infantry bugles on their forage caps?
Yeah, totally intentional. And
of course they wanted to make Robert Todd Lincoln hot. He's coming back
right.
to be with Lucy.
Yeah. There was a very intentional discussion with our costume designer, Mary Ancio, who is brilliant at a level that is hard to describe. And it was very important to us, especially in those early episodes, but really always, that our heroes are imperfect and that they don't get everything right. And there isn't either the time, or because they're not actually living in that time, there just isn't the total depth of knowledge, and that even Lucy, as brilliant as she is, you have to allow for your characters to make mistakes, and they can't be infallible because conflict and mistakes are what lead to interesting drama, right? So there was a very clear directive to have our characters screw up as much as possible, especially in the early episodes, and that was an example of one where I remember the early drafts of Tom's script, which was a brilliant script, is like, you know, Wyatt and Rufus showed up and they were like rocking these like perfect outfits that they, and I'm like, that's just, they're not, they shouldn't be that awesome yet. Like, they should mess up and they should have the wrong outfit.
It takes our TV show a week and a half to find these outfits.
Right. How do you find one in 24
hours? Where are they
going to
come up with one in 2 hours?
And honestly, like, I can boil down so much of my life to some early 80s Spielberg movie. And if you look at Michael J. Fox in Back to the Future, he literally, if you watch it with this in mind, it's kind of incredible. He literally makes a mistake in every single scene. And that's what makes him charming. And still remains important to me that these characters keep making mistakes. So yeah, that was for on purpose.
Well done.
Okay, over here.
First I want to say, I don't know if you've seen the picture of the box of noodles that spills and it says renewed timeless.
Oh.
That was me.
Oh, well, nice.
It just happened.
I did see that. I saw it on Twitter.
I was gonna make some soup in it.
Right on. That's awesome.
That just happened.
Thank you.
My question is, with the 80s episode, I think it's probably not the deepest question, but I think everyone's had it cross their minds. Why didn't you just have them, like, bring the dude a condom? Or, like, an STD pamphlet?
Yeah. You know.
Yeah, man.
Hang on.
How do you know?
Like, you've never heard of a guy who promised to wear a condom who then didn't.
Or, like, I mean, if you wanted him, you could have, like, given her like an STD pamphlet or something like that.
Well, I mean, in the heat of the moment, I mean, what am I gonna be, the condom police?
There were enough pockets in that members only jacket.
That's the reason.
Yeah.
Thank you.
That's an awesome question, by the way.
Yeah. They didn't have them back then. Next.
That seems historically inaccurate.
I don't know how to follow up with that one.
You can do it.
So my question actually is for Mr. Kripke and Mr. Ryan. I'm really interested in the writing component of this, and especially within this genre. And I know that you had said earlier that you prioritize character over the genre, you know, over those plot issues. But how do you avoid the spinning, you know, the spinning plates issue, especially in a time travel genre, where you can kind of go off into all these different infinitudes,
right,
and bring them back to the character?
The short answer is, it's probably not a short answer. It's a struggle, and it's not easy, and you have to just be very, very disciplined. Go ahead. You were gonna.
Yeah, I was gonna ask. The further question is, what are your rules at play then? In terms of the time travel. I mean, we know one in text, which is you can't go back to a time that you're already a part of.
Right.
What are the other rules at play?
it's funny, the other major rule that probably remains unspoken and always will, because it's there's a couple rules and they all make my head hurt and make me want to like ever so slightly want to put a gun in my mouth. But like, for instance, we had a really intense discussion in the room one day about, okay, so when, I'm so sorry for bringing this up, but you asked, if if you go back into the past and you make a change, are there now two parallel timelines, mm-hmm. or are there one? We decided in this world that there are one.
Okay.
Because there's no stakes if there's multiple. If you go back and you end up letting Lincoln survive, but there's still some other reality that you're from where he just went on exactly the way he was, mm-hmm. and now there's just this new branch, then all you're doing is making new branches. Mm-hmm. And there's no stakes to saving your world. And we made this decision very early on that we needed our characters to feel that they were always fighting for the stakes of existential threats to their own reality, which is why there's very subtle things in there, but you can tell, like when, for instance, it's so nerdy, I'm so sorry, but when Wyatt goes back to try to save his wife, and then he returns back to the present, Lucy's aware that he left, and he's aware that the wife is still dead, and she's completely conscious of the mission that he went on,
yeah.
which, were it an alternate timeline or something different, she might not be. She might be like, who are you, or, you know. So it's very important to us that there's only one reality. There's not like a multiverse. So it's like those types of rules. Every rule we come up with is a rule that is designed, because time travel, I mean, you know, it's
guys, time travel.
Time travel, people. And you want, we were really going for like the Quantum Leap style of fun.
Voyagers.
Voyager, okay, I love Voyagers. Like the dirty secret of this show is this is just a classy version of Voyagers. And that, like, I just loved that show when I was a kid, and I always wanted to make Voyagers, and now we get to, like, do Voyagers. So it's all about, and we say it to the writers all the time, because they're always pitching, mm-hmm. you know, these, like, these mind Fs that you fall into, of, mm-hmm. and we're just like, stop it! You know, like, just keep it simple. So
that's
the goal.
I think it raises the stakes of, where is Amy? You know, if this is the one time,
yes.
I think that's... That is,
where's,
you know,
Amy?
Dude, somebody needs to get him a doll.
Yeah.
Named Amy.
She's on an Amazon show called The Last Tycoon coming out later this year. You can find it.
Okay.
Yes, she is actually.
But so, but off of your question about the spinning plates, you know, my curiosity is, did someone approach Lucy's mother to say, we can make you better, but in making you better, the consequence is no Amy. Mm-hmm. But you're not going to remember because you never had her, but you're better. Guys,
that's like an evil.
That's not what happened at all.
No, that's not it. That's
too deep.
You're wrong.
Okay.
Well, great. Thank you.
There'll be a condom in season two, though. Just so you know.
Thank you for answering.
Hitler's
that.
Mother and father.
Thank
Hitler's
you. Thank
father
you
gets
question.
A condom. Episode two.
Hi. So you were saying earlier that, you know, American history has so many stories that you can tell. So is there any stories that, for whatever reason, you wouldn't want to tell? Thanks, guys.
You've literally
that sounds
never
like
been
a
asked.
Challenge,
yeah.
almost. Because, you know, I mean, sometimes I just flinch a little bit if I feel a story is getting too violent. And now that may sound strange coming from the creator of The Shield to say that, but to me, this show, you know, I started getting, you know, there were early drafts of the Alamo episode that I just felt was just getting a little too gruesome for my tastes, and you know, I want this, even though there is violence in the show, I want it to be something that 12, 13, 14, 15-year-olds can watch with their parents and get something out. I mean, you know, I have a 17-year-old daughter who, her history teacher in school started talking about this show in the class, having no idea that one of his class members' father co-created it. You know, I want that to happen. And the minute we sort of turn, you know, I mean, we could go back to Vietnam and do a platoon-esque episode, but I'm not sure that benefits overall in the show. I don't think there's any time period or genre that you know, that I'd be too afraid of going into, but so I'm not answering your question directly, but I'm just saying too violent to me in this environment for this show at this time isn't what I want to do.
I'd also say too played out. I'd say we tend to avoid, like, you know, people ask me a lot, like, are you going to ever do the Titanic? And I'm like, we're never going to do the Titanic. And like, I'm like,
Jack!
Right.
On Twitter, I joked that we were and that James Cameron was going to come direct the episode. It was going to have huge guest stars. And a lot of people thought I was being serious. Yeah.
So, look, this episode is a very well-known event. But we only did it because we were really confident that there were details about this event that not everybody knew.
Well, the other people they were trying to kill. Most people know that a dude shot Lincoln that night. But they don't always know about the conspiracy and the attempts on...
Right.
On Grant
or the connection between the Booth and the Lincoln family. And so we really want to avoid like the cliches of history. Like those stories have already been well told. And it's really important to us to tell, you know, like Malcolm was talking about earlier, like the underrepresented stories. And there's a whole world of story. I'm not being particularly like kind-hearted. Like it's totally self-serving. Like there's a million stories that people haven't heard. And those are stories where the heroes are female and people of color and are people who are underrepresented. And, you know, ultimately, we're just storytellers. And we want to tell stories that people haven't heard before that are exciting and emotional. And that's where the stories are. So that's why we're looking there. And so far, you know, I'd love to dig deeper into that in season two because there's so many out there.
All right. So question over here on this side of the room.
Hi.
Sorry. First off, just want to say thank you. There's a group of law students in Northwest D.C. who put our case books down for 42 minutes.
Oh, so thank you.
Nice.
Every Monday. But I think that one of the reasons why we're so drawn to Timeless despite of all of the other time travel shows out there is that although subtle, maybe, in my opinion, there are some political overtones with the Red Scare episode, Atomic City, even if you think of local politics with Al Capone, those sorts of things. And I was wondering if that was ever a discussion for you all. I think any of you even, I'm not sure how many episodes The Scholar has watched, but I was just wondering if that was ever a discussion at all.
We discuss a lot. And listen, it's, you know, people, we're always asking writers to come into the writer's room and bare their souls, right? I mean, you draw so much from your own personal life, and obviously we have writers who are political, and we were creating the show during a very intense political time last year. Having said that, I don't think it's the show's job to impose our politics on it, but I do think that it's appropriate, perhaps, to insert our values and our thought processes about things, you know, on issues such as racism or sexism or these other things. I don't think America really wants to hear which way Eric or I would vote, but I do think that we can shine a light on the human condition and we can see parallels. And if you want to draw a parallel between our Red Scare episode and things that were happening in the country in the last year, that's up to you, you know, and I wouldn't discourage that. But there are all kinds of conversations about what's going on in the world, what's going on in our lives, how we interpret certain things, and how we can use those thoughts to bring them to screen. Add anything to that? Or?
Perfect answer.
No, I think you guys do a great job because obviously misogyny or racism or homophobia, you know, will... as much as we don't want it to exist, we'll probably always exist and we'll battle against it, but you guys do a good job of, you know, confronting that without beating people over the head.
Well, one example, and this is something Eric taught me, because Eric taught me that you can do these kinds of stories in genre in ways that are hard. I think audiences have gotten cynical in recent years, right? And the minute that an audience member feels they're being preached to, I think they turn something off, especially if you're preaching something that they don't believe in. And so Eric was the first one to teach me. I never really thought of it this way, that genre you could tell this. So to tell a story with Rufus interacting with a white police officer in 1937 in the pilot is commenting on Black Lives Matter and police versus the African American community, but in a way that I think is more palatable to people than me creating a show that's about, you know, a black officer in 2017 having problems with cops. In some ways, you can dive a little deeper into it with the genre.
Yeah, ultimately, all good sci-fi is a metaphor. Anyone who, you know, gives a shit about sci-fi about making it good is doing that, making metaphors for the human condition. And so you can hide a lot of commentary and a lot of thought in the metaphor of your genre that you could never get away with in an earnest sort of straight drama.
Good writing. Great writing, you know?
And so, amazing writing.
And acting. We have one more question over here.
Yes, we're running short of time, but Eva Barrett, Malcolm's mom, is right there, and we'd love her to...
Oh, let's... Yes!
Shame on you, shame on you, shame on you. I was trying to give other folks a chance to say something.
But no, we want to hear from Mom. Mike, we want to hear from
I'm
Mom.
I'm only going to say that I truly appreciate the great actors and actresses on time.
Yes.
All right, just a moment. I appreciate the writers.
Oh, yes. Thank you. Thank you, dear.
Mom, can you come up here?
I appreciate all of you.
Mom, can you come up here and give your son a kiss?
Timeless.
Come up here and give your son a kiss. Yeah.
It was a really good question.
Eva, you have to come up here.
I didn't know you could turn red, Malcolm.
No. We want Mom to come up here and give Malcolm a kiss. You got, please, you know?
Did not have to ask twice.
Yes. There is nothing better than a proud mother.
Are there more questions?
Yes. No.
From the audience.
Yes. Yes. And I think that is a perfect moment to wrap up our discussion. We have to wrap up because I have a special presentation that's a surprise to you right now. Chris Wilson with the Smithsonian is going to be giving an award.
Right. So, first of all, thank you all so much for coming out and being a part of the first night of the History Film Forum. There's a lot more to go. We have programs Friday, Saturday, and Sunday here, premiere documentaries. You can be the first audiences to see several films and great panel discussions. So if you like what you saw, one, come back and see more of it. And also share, and you see all the Twitter handles and so forth, share on social media and let us know what you thought of it. We really want to build this program and keep it going. We also, again, want to thank, this was so fun. You really want to thank our panel. And as was pointed out during it, you know, we love when filmmakers and entertainers use history, as Brian said, to use entertainment to spread the words of history, and we would like to present to the creators of Timeless these certificates saying that in appreciation for your participation in the History Film Forum and for what you've done for public history. So thank you so much. Thank you all for coming out, and this concludes our program. Hope to see you again this weekend. Take care.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, guys.
Renew Timeless. Tell your friends to stream it.